Keeping on schedule with Lightning Talks, next we have Emmanuel.
Yep. The clicker, this one? Okay. Hi, so I'm the last one standing between you and the lunch. So as you all know, in Google, there's a value of food a lot, so I'm gonna try and be as quick as possible. So 3 hours to 3 minutes. I usually give this presentation for about 40 minutes, and now I have to eat my own dog food and do it for about 10, 12. So let's start. So what is this all about? We had a bunch of API tests, and we used to run them every night. It took 3 hours to run them, and now they run for 3 minutes. So this is the actual scale, 60 times faster. This white dot for you guys at the back, this is three again. So that's the actual scale. So how did we do that? So now it's, it comes before and after slide, like those infomercials. So this is the actual screenshot of the Jenkins. As you can see, 3 hours, 3 hours. The last run here was 4 hours and 40 minutes. And we used to run them every night. And what would happen in the morning, we usually, we're going to have to play whack-a-mole, find the developers responsible for the breakage. And it was hard because you go to the first developer, and what did you do yesterday? He would say, I don't remember. I got drunk last night. Don't ask me. Ask the other guy. You go to the other guy. He'd say, I fell in love with this girl. I don't know. I don't remember. So it was really tough. So we said, OK, this enough of this bullshit. So we set a goal. Let's run all of that for 3 minutes. So why 3 minutes? Basically, the idea was to give comprehensive feedback after every code change to the developers. And after every code change, you run all the tests that you have. No more smoke tests, no more nightly runs, and so forth. So this is the situation now. So 2 minutes, 2 minutes. This is a little bit more than 3 minutes. You want to see some numbers today, and the numbers are not going to be meaningful to you. They mean to us, but not to you. And you're going to see some techniques that are not brand new. There is no magic fairy dust, but it's all about continuous improvement. This is what we all have in common. All of us are unique snowflakes, unique challenges in our companies. But if you set up a goal and take small incremental steps to achieve this goal, put the time and the effort, you will achieve some amazing results. So this is our journey. So the first thing that we did is dedicated environment. All the tests were running on environment that was shared with the developers that were used to put their code together before pushing it on production. We didn't have a dedicated environment. So the first thing that we did is run everything in dedicated environment only for automated tests. So this is how we start 180 minutes. By having a dedicated environment, we were down to about an hour of the execution time. So the next thing that we had to do is databases. We were still using the shared database because it contained a lot of data useful for those tests. This database was heavily used by bad jobs and some other stuff that happened during the night. So we figured out if we wanted to really fast test, we need to have a separated database. But this was a problem because we had to rework most of our tests to insert the data that they need. So we had to re-engineer the framework. It might sound a little bit crazy, but this is what happens right now before every test case. So we call a bunch of APIs, and we manually, if we don't have access to the APIs, we manually change something in the databases or add some rows just to set up the playing field, just to do the setup, and then the real test case starts. Before that, it's only setup, but being able to do that means that now we can run the tests on empty database, on full, on dirty, on integration, on stage. We don't run those in production because it's a little bit risky, but you get the idea. Basically, we are free to use every database. So we've saved about 30 minutes with that. So next thing, external dependencies. What we do is software as a service. We collect a lot of data from the biggest social networks, even sorry, Google Plus is also there. sorry, someone's from Google Plus team. So the idea was that all of the test cases had in one way or another connecting to external service. And if this service was down, say Twitter was down and the test case were failing, and this didn't have anything to do with the developer pushing the new code. So we wanted to basically stub, fake, simulate, you know, pick whatever you like, those with something that we control, so that now I believe Google calls these hermetic servers. Like, you don't have access to the outside world. Everything is wrapped up and doesn't leave your network. So this is the, I don't know if you see the font. This is the landscape as of Sprint of this year, a bunch of open source tools, WireMock, SOAP UI, Mock Server, Stubby4j that we evaluated, but we had some specific requirements, like being able to act as a transparent SSL proxy, basically. We wanted to monitor all the connections and figure out which we want to fake and which we want to pass to the real service. I want to be able to return some real binary data, have some local storage, dynamic responses, et cetera. And none of those would fit the bill. So we didn't want to do it, but we had to develop our own tool to basically scratch our own itch. It's called Project Nagel. It's going to be open source really soon. We're waiting for some external stuff to happen. It's really cool. And you'll be able to check it out, I think, in a month or so. So by having by stubbing all the external dependencies, faking HTTP traffic, we didn't gain much in terms of speed, but we gained a lot in terms of stable tests for non-flaky tests. For us, the biggest reason for flaky tests was the external services. And sometimes the internet is down or is slow, but now we control everything. So moving to containers, we didn't want to do that initially, but we had this big monolithic application, and the developers decided that it's a wise idea to start splitting this whole big monolith to a smaller services. And we basically had to follow suit. But we didn't have enough servers to mimic what the production environment looks like, so we had to use containers. And we used Docker, so what we did was create one service, one container. And when we run all the tests, we were actually in a big surprise. The execution time grew. And we started scratching our heads, and you see, I did a lot of scratching. Until we figured out what the problem was, we used Docker. So as you know, it uses layered file system, and it's really bad if you have high disk IO operations. So we measured that for our case, it was about 3 times as low the IO performance than using a real file system. So our biggest user of file system IO was the databases. So we figured out, okay, let's run the databases in memory, so to see how did we go. Because we don't need the data, it's only fake data, we run everything in memory. Now, so we go back to where we started, basically, but at least it didn't get worse. So next. Don't remove test data. What we used to have a logic in the framework, back when we were using the shared testing environment, each test case would create the data, and then at the end it would delete the test data so that we don't pollute the whole environment when we do manual tests. But now we did not need that anymore because we have dedicated environment. And the thing is, when you stop the container, just the data evaporates. So there is no need for this heavy logic to do that kind of search and deletion. So we are down to about 46 minutes. And it's not much, but every little bit helps when you are up at that point. So the next thing that we did was the obvious thing that usually everyone starts with, so run stuff in parallel. According to our experience, this should be one of the last things that you do, run stuff in parallel. When you run them in parallel and you get variation in execution time, so you don't know if it's a normal variation or it's something caused by, you know, you trying to improve the system. So try to expand all your other options and then try to run in parallel. That's the actual graph of the threads that we run testing and the execution time. Each one took, as you can see, it's easy to see the optimal value is 10 threads for this. This is per hardware specific, so if we add more memory and CPU, it may shift to the right. But we run those in 10 threads, and so the execution time was about five minutes. Still a little bit off our initial goal of 3 minutes, so we had to do something else. And it turned out, equalizing workload, it turned out that the software that we used to run all the tests, the driver, it did not do a good job to separate the test cases equally into each thread. So as you can see, thread number 3 had about 130 test cases in it. So everyone had to wait for thread number 3 while the other were idle. So we had to manually readjust the workload. So this is the picture after. And it's not perfect, but it did the job. So we were down to about 3 minutes. So this is how the whole picture looks like. The actual results were even a little bit better. So that's a screenshot, and they took two minutes and 15 seconds. But this doesn't make for a good presentation title. It's mouthful. 3 hours to 2 minutes and 15 seconds. So stick to 3 hours to 3 minutes. And at this point, we have exhausted our options to optimize via the software. So our only option was now to go after the hardware. So a couple of months ago, we upgraded basically mostly the RAM and the CPU, the machine that we run, and now the tests run for 1 minute and 38 seconds without doing anything else. This runs on single machine, on single server. If we wanna go below the 1 minute mark, and this is what right now what we're doing, it's super easy right now to scale horizontally. And so this is our current option. This is what we're gonna do. We're aiming for sub 1 minute execution time. Just for comparison, our unit tests run for about 45 seconds, about 3,000 of them. But they don't touch the database, the network, and the file system. Those guys do. When you have high level tests, these are the most of the complaints that you get. Compared to unit tests, everything else is slow. So we accidentally addressed all the issues that we had with high API and UI level tests. So they're not slow now. They run for 3 minutes, and we're aiming for less than 1 minute. They're not unreliable. Like I said, we control all the dependencies, and no one else uses those machines, so they're only dedicated for fast tests. The entropy is lower. This is a little bit harder. Cannot pinpoint the problem exactly. Sometimes when your test fail high-level test, you get internal server error, and you don't know. You're lucky if you get a stack trace. But most of the times, you just get internal error. Something happens somewhere, so it's really hard to figure out exactly what. But having so much faster tests actually changed the behavior of the developers. Now they start to getting used to this fast feedback, and before they used to push their code once a week, from once a week to 2-3 days a week to once a day to every hour. And when they push 3 lines of code and the test fail, then it's pretty obvious which of the 3 lines is a problematic one. So by having super cheap and fast, reliable tests to run, so we actually run everything on every commit. Like we run static code analysis, we run linters, we run custom tools, unit tests, and those tests. So there's nothing else to run after each commit. We are able to push in production or continue to manually test if we like. And those are no longer problems for us. What we think is that in the future, this is what we should aim for, to be able to run all of your tests, not only the unit tests, but everything for no more than 3 minutes. We think that this is going to become a standard development practice the way right now we put all our code in version control system and we use CI. So this a couple of years ago, this was I consider a crazy practice. But what you want to do is keep developers in the flow. What happens if you have a pipeline that it takes 15, 20 minutes to run all your tests? So developer pushes their code, and what happens is they go, while they're waiting, they go to check their Google Plus said no one ever. Facebook page. They go to make a coffee, make a sandwich. They check their, Tinder app, Grindr, whatever your thing is. And when they come back, 15, 20 minutes later, they have forgotten all of that stuff. Build failed. What did I do? The idea is to keep everyone in the flow. Okay. So keep them in the flow. That's my last slide. Two books to help you with your journey. The first is The Goal by Elihu Goldratt. Introduces the theory of constraints. So basically, you have one big bottleneck. You work on this bottleneck. Then you have additional bottlenecks, but they are not visible until you fix the bigger bottleneck. It's basically reads as a business novel. The next one is Toyota Kata by Mike Rother. Introduces a continuous improvement kata. So you set up a goal and you take the small PDCA cycles by Dr. Deming, Plan, Do, Check, Act. And you take every day, you take small steps. And when you hit a problem, take a step back, the way we did with the containers. So that's all I had to say. Thank you.
Excellent. Thanks, Emmanuel. And I thought my comments on JavaScript were harsh. Google Plus burn. Ouch.
I hope they didn't do a parking lot therapy at the Google Plus.
I think you're okay. We probably have time for one question. How do you ensure your API stubs stay current if and when the stubbed API changes?
Yeah, that's a very common question. So so there are three things. The first thing is that we deal say Facebook or Twitter APIs, and they announce a new version, and we initially don't switch first to this version. We switch only internally to using the, say, version 2.8. And if we detect some problems with the stubs, we adjust the stubs. We have time to do that. And when we are all set up and we think we're ready in testing, then we push to production. Then we use two other things. We also do extensive monitoring. So if we monitor some problems, we adjust the stubs. We also, the third thing that we do is we do a lot of contract tests. We basically ping Facebook or Twitter or Google Plus for is this the JSON that we expect to be? So every 10 minutes or less, we do those kinds of tests. And we did not used to do those kind of tests, but what happens is that Facebook at one point changed a little bit in their JSON responses. They added additional field just for one day, and it caused us thousands of dollars of losses for us because we didn't handle this case. So we learned our lesson, and we use contract tests to check if what they return is really what they said that they would return.
All right, very good. Another round of applause.
Yeah. So thank you.